Okay, great. All right, we're going to start with recipient site creation. This is a logical sequence from donor harvesting. As your team is preparing the grafts, you're making the recipient sites. And recipient sites are, again, what where your grafts are going to go into. Obviously, these are poorly... Get a little feedback, Mike. Maybe these are too close. Done? Good. I think we're okay. Oh, that's going to be near that one.
Oh, okay.
That's right. That's fine. So obviously, you don't want to create these kind of recipient sites because the hairline's too straight. These are large grafts. These look weird. Or you don't want to create recipient sites that look like this or put hairs that look like that. Clearly, that's undesirable. You've seen some of the corrective work I've shown you that are not plugs that still look weird. And so part of it is designing. We go back. I show you this for the 15th time. Or maybe it's the 17th time, that says understand hair loss patterns, understand geography of the scalp, okay? Understand hair angles and directions on a scalp so that you can design patterns that make sense. Sorry, this is jumpy. So understand so you can design patterns that make sense. These are, again, some examples that I've shown you already. I've shown you slides over and over again. This is like a cult here. Just so you can create designs that look good, okay? And in all areas of the scalp. So remember the box. Those are some quick review ideas of understanding where how to make recipient sites that are tailored to the various parts of the scalp. My favorite instruments are just bent needles. So the great thing about these they're plentiful, they're cheap, and they work well. And these, I make little slits with them. I typically use an 18-gauge needle to accommodate 3 hair grafts, depending on the size. I use a 19 gauge for 2 hair grafts and 20 gauge for 1 hair graft. Sometimes I use 21 gauge, just depending on the size of the follicles. But the key thing is you don't want to traumatize. And these may be too small for your assistants to place into. If your assistants are traumatically placing these into these sites, you want to go larger, maybe a 16 gauge site. I'd rather the graft's got to fit the site. But if your staff is not skilled enough to place into smaller sites, you're going to create damage to the follicle, and that's more important than anything else. Also, when I'm doing FUE grafts, you heard from Bassam how fragile they are. Because they're more fragile, I typically use slightly larger sites to limit the damage to the graft, because the more graft that is damaged, the more problem there are. To break it down, there are many ways to make recipient sites, but these are the 3 fundamental ways. You can make one with what's called a sagittal or parallel. Those are the same words. They mean they're this direction, okay? Coronal or perpendicular sites go this direction. And then punch ones are actually taking a little scalp out. I've gone through all 3. I'm sort of really favoring the sagittal. Sagittal, the benefit of it is, and I don't want to make this too difficult to understand, but sagittal's very little transection rate, very easy to place. They direct your hairs in the way that you want it to go. Negative of sagittals is that if you think about it, if this is your graft and you put it in sagittally, it can ride up a little, your angles could change a little bit, and maybe it's too high. So if you have a larger site, it's a little bit more problematic. Coronals, the benefit is they don't ride up. So also when you're using larger grafts, like 3 hair grafts, if you put them this way, okay, they can ride up a little bit. When you put them this way in a coronal fashion, they can splay more, like an awning, and you may be able to cover your hair a little bit better. So a lot of times I'll use sagittals for my 1 or 2 hair sites. I use coronals for my 3 hair sites, and that way my staff know how to place into those sites. I'll show you some of those design patterns in a moment. And then micropunches I did for a while, wrote a chapter about it, thought it was fantastic because you're taking bald scalp out. But there's a little variability in the vascularity compromise when you can, you know, even with a lot of tumescent solution, you can have some issues. So I've steered away from micropunch again in the last couple of years and moved more back toward sagittals primarily with some coronals, and that works for me. You know, you're going to hear a lot of marketing hype of the punch is better. You're going to hear the coronal or the lateral slit or the, you know, a lot of this is marketing. And so what I want to get to is understanding what may work for you, which may work for your staff and your team, may not work for me and vice versa. These are just paintbrushes. These are tools of design. That's all it is. And you're going to use those and learn how to use them. I recommend for all of you to start and maybe continue with sagittal. If this is confusing, you said, now you got the overview. I remember the first ISHRS meeting I went to, I said, what the heck is a perpendicular? I would tell you sagittals are the way to go. For the majority of people in this room, you should start with sagittals. Tomorrow when we do the workshop, I'm going to only teach you sagittals, okay? So just, I want to have the overview, but then I want to be pragmatic for you. Remember, when we use a vocabulary to discuss this, when I talk to you, I say change your angle. I'm talking about AP, okay? And when I talk about direction, we're talking about this direction, okay? So I want you to remember that. You saw from Bassam some beautiful recipient sites, and you saw the way he creates the wave and it fits the hair. For men, I want to make it easy for you. I want you to try to make most of your recipient sites going straight forward, okay? That's how I make a lot of my sites. And the reason for this is that it's very easy to follow radially a scalp like this. When you do this, which is a natural tendency, okay, you're going to see your hands do that. They're going to book leave open, and it's going to be hard to create visual density doing that. So I'd rather, if anything, you converge in a little bit or go straight, then splay. And you're going to see when you start to make these recipient sites in the lab tomorrow, your left side is going to be different from your right side. If you're just starting to do this, I've seen people 5 years in practice, 10 years in practice, still make recipient sites that are not the same on the left and the right. It's because the scalp is rounded. The topography is three-dimensional. So I'm going to look for your consistency. That's really, really important. And then here's an example of just a recipient site creation in a sequential fashion. So this is just drawing a little, what's called a snail trail line of the hairline. And this is actually probably about a year old slide, and I've changed my technique, and I'll show you in a schematic how I changed it. So we're constantly refining this. You know, I probably give another presentation in 6 months, it'll be completely different. So I used to build my base hairline with my two hair sites. And then I went and finessed it with one hair sites, feathered it out, put those sentinels here, which are the little hairs that stand out in front of the hairline, framed it with the one hairs and threw some sentinels out there, and then I came back and finished it with some three and two hairs to build up central density. The easiest way to think about a hairline is got to be irregularly irregular. Now, what we're talking about is the micro hairline, this hairline that is composed of recipient sites. The previous hairline that I designed was the macro hairline, which is the shape and position. Now we're talking about finessing it so it no longer looks like a line. And the easiest way for me to describe that to you is like a shoreline. There are little, you know, nooks and crannies of the hairline, little jetties. The hairline of a shoreline at a large distance, if you look at California hairline, if you look at a California coastline, it looks relatively straight, and the closer you magnify and you go in, the more irregular it is. And that's the way a hairline should look. So this schematic that I'm going to show you is the way I now do a hairline. And it's changed. I've gone through a lot of iterations. So I first draw the hairline. Then what I do is I start with my one hair sites now. I find even more control by starting at the smallest level and working out. So I'll make I'll take that straight line and make a tight, irregularized hairline of one hairs. And then I come back and I further finesse that line, making some little jetties of additional hairs that stick out in front. Then I come back again and I further irregularize it with, maybe I find a little hole there, a little there. I'm using a lot more one hair grafts. In the past I'd use like 100, 150. I've got up to 200 to 500 now. And I find the further one hair grafts that I make, the more undetectable the hairline is, the softer the hairline is, the more beautiful that hairline is. Then after my third pass, I come back for a fourth pass to rebuild and further irregularize it. So you're constantly looking at it. I sometimes get in front of the patient and look at it and look at the shape. Then I come back over here. That is the thing that takes me the longest, is making that hairline look as seamless, as beautiful as possible. And I find now that the one hair is a central aspect of my making that look good. Then I come back now and I start building my two hair graft sites with my 19 gauge or 20 gauge needle or whatever it may be, building backwards. I build more two hairs. Remember, at this area, you don't want it to be too strong. It will look fake. Because this area of recession, I build more two hairs going out. And then I want central density. So sometimes I'll use coronal sites. And those coronal sites are also easy for my staff to know what a two and a three hair is. So I'll make that in my central forelock and build that way. The other thing that's important when you're making recipient site is that God did not make any abrupt changes to the head. What that means is that when I go from the frontal zone, as I go to the temple, it's a gradual transition. When I do the crown, There's no abrupt sweep. It's not like I go from an angle here, then go here. It every angle change is subtle in flows. So think of it that way. No abrupt changes. When I'm seeing you do your recipient sites, I want to make sure that you make your recipient sites in a way that there's no abrupt change. I'm going to be looking at that and adjusting that behavior as you're doing it. Also, the other thing that I haven't mentioned so far is that my sites are interlocked, meaning, think about this. When you make a first row like this, okay, you want your second row between them, and then your third row between them. The reason for this is you can make them closer together. They don't compete for space, and they also create visual blockade, so you don't see through it. If you make them all in parallel rows, you can see through better. So for all those reasons, you want to stagger your rows, make them interlocked. I'm going to be looking at that for you tomorrow. I'm going to be looking at you making recipient sites that are, you know, 20 follicular units per square centimeter. And I'll tell you, my first year of practice, every night I took a melon and I made these sites. Okay, so you're going to get good at doing this over and over and over and over and over. And I'm going to give you the tools to create self-criticism so that you can take a melon, go home, and go, oh yeah, Sam told me my left, I got to make my left look like my rights. I got to make sure the hairline's more irregularized. I got to make sure that I put enough one hair grafts. I got to make sure that I'm not splaying over to one side and rounding it, you know, in this way. I got to make sure that I put 900 sites into a square centimeter distance of this much. I got to practice to make sure I consistently build 20 follicular units per square centimeter. I wanted to see if I can consistently build 45 follicular units per square centimeter. So those are the exercises that I will give you tomorrow, because in a short time you're not going to be able to do all that. And then if you come to St. Louis or the ISHRS meeting and go through some of these labs again, you're going to then have a 6-month interval, and then someone's going to look at you do that again and you go, oh my God, I still made this error. But the rest of it I got right. Cool. Okay? So this is the thing. I'm going to give you tools of criticism that is going to lead to self-criticism, and that's going to lead you to be able to design better work. And that's what's so great about a workshop, is that lectures are a great start, but they are useless without getting your hands wet. So you've got to get your hands wet to understand this, and then you're going to get the feedback and see where I see one guy doing everything wrong with density issues. Another, but he's doing everything right in terms of his straightness. And then I come back and I figure this other guy's doing something wrong with density patterns, but he's doing, you know, better with something else. So, and then I go back in 20 minutes and they've all corrected those things. So they've added one new error. Then I've corrected that. They write down those errors and they go back and now they know these are the six things they got to make sure that they work on every night until they get good at it, okay? And this is showing you how, as you go over the temple, there's no abrupt change. This is a soft transition point. And this is another example of a temple where I've done coronal sites. So these are, if you look, these sites are sagittal, and then when we go down here, they're coronal, going this way, instead of sagittal going that way, so that they lie flatter, better. And this is a pattern showing you how I've done sagittals going into coronals, which are three hair grafts, sites designed for three hair grafts. This is, and also, I've made a subtle convergence going inward because the hairs, this is an esoteric point, but this is just some of the creativity. Because the scalp falls open and book leaves, if you can make your patterns converge a little bit, it's going to look better because the area of prime density that's important for you is your hairline and your central forelock. Central forelock is defined as where my fist is right here, okay? And that's an area of importance to create some visual density for. And this is just another design pattern. These are just designs, and they're not to be good or bad. They're just my design patterns to start to show you that this is cool. And this is just, you can see that no abrupt change. Everything just flows and goes from the crown. And you look at a person's natural crown, and the best person to look at to understand how hair grows, someone non-balding with a short cropped hair. If you can find that and go study his hair, you can see how his crown, when the whorl goes forward, it goes up to the lateral hump and it's a smooth transition. When the whorl comes forward, it goes forward like this and it splays almost like my hand before it goes into the mid-scalp. These little transitional points where there's no abrupt change is important, and I encourage you, document all this. And I love doing this. It's like my little painting at the end, which is like the I told you, like the Gunner diagram, where you can, and I tried at one meeting to explain this, and I even got lost explaining this. So it's pointless for me to explain the diagrams. My point of this is that they're fun, and they're a way to accurately record what you did. You can go back and look at what you did. Just like when you look at your rhinoplasty a year later and you're judging what your work is. I'm going back and seeing if there's anything that didn't look as good, I could do better based on these diagrams. So be an artist, have fun, come to more meetings, and we're moving on. Okay, final talk.